Welcome to AT&T's teleconference service. Please enter your access code, followed by the pound sign. To join the conference, as the host, press star, otherwise. Please enter your host password, followed by the pound sign. There are 1 participants on the call, including you. You are joining your conference as the host. For a menu of available commands, press star, pound.
Okay. Yes, ma'am.
Commissioner Perez?
Permanent.
I'm just quiet. I'm not over my age. I'm not in that game.
Everyone signed in who wants to speak.
First, my first official update, or will be, is in regards regard to my last official action, standing in for Dr. Holliday. She'll be coming back on November 16th, I hope, which is also the day that I and a few of our commissioners are going to be going down to Utopian Academy of the Arts for our official site visit. Commissioners Perez, Hogg, Werner, and Lewis will be on that visit with me. And we've actually gone to Utopian Academy, a few of us, on several occasions, but this will be our first official site visit to see all the good things that they're doing with the students down in Clayton County. So we're looking forward to that in just a little over 2 weeks.
Super. Have we had one since our last meeting? Lauren Holcomb, Organizational Development.
Good morning. So our recent trainings that we've had, on October 14th, we had our new school orientation webinar, and this is, we invited all of the newly approved schools who were just approved in the last petition cycle, and we'll be opening up next fall to a webinar. We had participation from all of the schools, and this is just to orient them to the expectations of them throughout the planning year. So we walked through the opening, pre-opening checklist that Terrence puts together so they know what they need to be doing throughout the planning year. And walked them through our website so they know where guidance and resources are and explain all of the trainings that are available to them. So we are expecting good participation from them throughout the planning year, and they're going to be coming to some of the other trainings that the operational schools come to, and they should be hopefully ready to go next fall. Our upcoming trainings, we have our governance training next week at Little Ocmulgee State Park. That's the first of two governance trainings. The next one will be in February, and that will be locally based here in Atlanta at Stone Mountain. We are at capacity now for next week's training, but anyone who wants to attend the February training is welcome to do so, and they can just shoot me an email if they want to attend. Our new school orientation will be December 2nd. This again is for the newly approved schools from this last petition cycle. That will be held here in our building on the opposite tower in the Empire Room. And at this training, we have invited state people from DOE, from GCSA, from our office, and we'll be walking them through more detail about what's expected of them throughout the planning year, things that they need to do to get their facility ready, for title programs, special education requirements, for student recruitment, anything that they need in the planning year, we're gonna let them know about those resources. And then lastly, an upcoming training in December is our petitioner boot camp, the first of two petitioner boot camps, and that one will be located here in Atlanta. And just to let everyone know, we've made a few changes to the boot camps this year. We've added a second day to the Atlanta boot camp that will be exclusively focused on budgets, because that's a problem that we've seen repeated throughout our two petition cycles since I've been here. A lot of times petitioners struggle with budgetary and financial issues, so we're going to focus that second day exclusively on budget. And we'll be reaching out to everyone who applied last year who was not successful and inviting them to attend this year as well. And then in January, we'll have a second boot camp, which will be in Macon. And we're also going to have a series of webinars for the folks who can't make it out to the boot camp so that they can get those resources to them as well.
That's great. A lot of great trainings. Any questions for Lauren? We'll go back to Gregg with our accountability update.
I was hoping to be able to give the commissioners a brief update on how our schools did on the Georgia Milestones Assessment. It was scheduled to be with the state school or district level results were scheduled to be released in October. Unfortunately, but not unexpectedly, we hit a snag with that timeline. So it's going to be another couple weeks before we have Georgia Milestones Assessments. There was some end of, and it's, I was told, and I'm not a testing person, so bear with me, that there were needed to be additional norming for the end of grade assessments. So that pushed things back a couple weeks in accordance with advice from the technical testing advisory committee. So hopefully I will have that for you in November. On the plus side, that will give us some additional time that if it's released soon, to be able to go a little bit more in depth than I would have been able to this month. So hopefully we'll have that in November, and hopefully we'll be able to provide you some positive results of how our state charter schools did last year. Two quick other things I want to mention on accountability, just for our schools in the audience and the commissioners, we have started our SCSC on-site monitoring activities this year. We always do kind of a document review where we gather all pertinent policies and procedures of schools any student handbooks, faculty handbooks, and we just do in-depth review to make sure everything is legally compliant from that standpoint. We also go on site to the schools. We meet with school leaders and staff, inspect the facilities for major school safety issues. And this year we're going to be attending some board meetings as well. So that's something that we started. We've already gone to one school, and we will be hopefully be able to get to all the schools by the time March rolls around. And then finally, I know all of you have seen the ominous looking vanilla folders that you've got. This is an update from the Georgia Department of Audits and Accounts, who are conducting a performance audit of virtual school performance. They began this process earlier this year in March or April. They met with SCSC staff and have contacted the schools. And what you have before you is their performance audit plan of how they're going to continue and complete their work. So that's something that we'll continue to work with them on. They're mainly, as you can see from the plan, interested in the performance of schools, as well as accountability measures, specifically regarding enrollment and funding. So we will be one of the many interested stakeholders to see how the results of that performance audit when it comes available.
Gregg, I know we had let them know that we had done some work on the virtual school and spent some money and time and effort on doing some studies of our own. Are they taking that into account and working with that, or are they furthering it?
They have seen it and considered it. They are working not exactly in furtherance, but not exactly in conflict. So they're continuing to do some independent work, but not very much on the academic overlap.
Can you remind us how many virtual schools are operating in Georgia?
Sure. We have three state chartered virtual schools. They are Georgia Connections Academy, Georgia Cyber Academy, Graduation Achievements Charter High School. There are a few districtly approved options, and there's one in particular that was called out, and I shouldn't say called out, that was mentioned in the plan, and that is Montgomery Charter Academy, run by the Montgomery County School District. And I think the reason that the auditors are interested in that program is because it's also operated by the same management company as Georgia Cyber Academy. So they're kind of interested in seeing how those two schools interact with each other, or to the extent that they do or don't.
Any other questions? All right.
Madam Chair,
yes,
Jose?
Yes.
Is there a chance you guys could mail that to me?
Absolutely. We do have one for you, and we'll mail it to you. We'll also scan it and email it to you as well.
Very good. Thank you.
All right, now to our financial compliance report with
Tanta. Thank you. Just as a reminder, the SCSC schools are contractually obligated to submit their audit reports to the agency at October 1st of each year. So the staff can monitor their fiscal health and performance and make sure they're living up to their goals. In September, we gave an extension to the audit report deadline. These were mainly for schools that utilize the Department of Audits and Accounts. They use them for some schedules, footnotes, and things like that. The Department of Accounts, they help schools and districts out by providing these to them each year. Now, there's been a lot of change with the way pensions are accounted for and things like that, and it's kind of slowed the process down a little bit. So we gave the schools an extension until November 14th. If they can provide their draft audit report to us by our normal due date of October 1st. Many of the schools submitted their draft reports to us, and some schools actually had their final audit reports already available, and they submitted them to us as well.
Thank you. Any questions for Terrence? Thanks, Terrence. Now we will move to our 2015 State Charter School Petition Review Process Update with Morgan.
Okay, good morning. Our first item of business is regarding Brighton Academy. As you guys will recall, they were the only remaining petition left in our 2015 pipeline. Since our last meeting, Brighton received local board approval to extend their charter term by 1 year, as the local board and school discuss the school's inclusion in future local revenue projects. As a result of that approval, the SCSC staff notified Brighton that we are not authorized to approve its petition. So no further action is needed by the SCSC regarding the petition for Brighton Academy. And that concludes our 2015 petition review cycle for our first-time applicants. Second order of business is with regard to two state charter schools, Ivy Prep Young Men's Leadership Academy and CCAT. Both of these are in the final year of their contracts. At our November meeting, we plan to share with you all our plan for reviewing those schools. Consistent with past precedent, the review process will largely focus on data with regard to academic, financial, and operational performance. So unlike for new schools, we focus on past performance instead of the operational plan submitted in a petition. We do plan to conduct an interview with each school's leadership and governing board to discuss their performance and prospects for a future term. Commissioners will be included in the interview and the renewal process. However, I should mention that the process is quicker than the process for new schools. However, there is some ambiguity on our timeline at this point in time due to what Gregg mentioned earlier and the delay in getting the CCRPI data for the 2014-2015 school year. Our goal is to normally have a recommendation to the SCSC for action at the February meeting, and this allows students and staff to prepare for the next school year, but unfortunately the action may need to be pushed back if data is not yet available. So we hope to have more information on that for you at our next meeting, both with regard to the renewal process and when that data will be available.
Any questions for Morgan? Okay, thanks, Morgan. I think we'll stick with you as we move to our process items. The first item for our review is a charter amendment for Cirrus Charter Academy.
Correct. Cirrus is requesting a charter amendment to adjust its educational and operational model due to the loss of its education service provider as contemplated in its petition. They'd originally planned to contract with String Theory Schools. However, some complications arose with String Theory due to their tax-exempt status that necessitated that Cirrus Academy and String Theory terminate their relationship. In its amendment request, Cirrus now proposes to contract with Prestige Charter Solutions to provide many of the services that would previously have been provided by String Theory. Any remaining services will be provided in-house by Cirrus. We've reviewed the information the school provided, and the staff is confident that the school will be able to implement the models that are consistent with those in its petition. The second part to the amendment has to do with requests to add a year to the charter term, and this is to ensure that they have 5 years of operation in the charter term. We've expressed to the school and to our commissioners that the staff is supportive of that amendment request also, given that the delay in Cirrus's operation was through no fault of their own.
So we have a recommendation that the proposed charter amendment for Cirrus Academy to provide for a new service provider and add a year to its term be approved. Do we have a motion and a second, and we can have discussion?
Certainly.
We have a motion?
Second.
And a second, thank you. Discussion or questions on this proposal? Hearing none, I'll ask for a vote. All those in favor of approving the recommendation as stated, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed?
Aye.
Hearing none, motion passes. Thank you. The next item of business or action item is the charter amendment for CCAT. Greg?
Excellent. I'm excited for this charter amendment. I don't get to say that often, but last month the commission voted to adopt the performance framework that was worked on by staff and schools for the past year. And while it will be mandated for new schools going forward, including existing schools when they renew their charter term, it's optional for existing schools because they've got existing contracts and existing performance goals. We definitely encourage our schools to consider using that as their basis for academic, financial, and operational accountability for a variety of reasons. We believe it to be a more fair and accurate tool, as well as to be more clear and transparent for both the school and its stakeholders. And we've got our first school taking us up on that. That's the Charter Conservatory for Liberal Arts and Technology, better known as CCAT, down in Statesboro. They submitted a request to utilize the performance framework as their measure of accountability for the remaining charter term. Of course, this is their final year of their charter. We gave them a three-year charter. So for this three-year charter term, we'll be using the data for in performance framework for measuring their accountability for renewal. Because we think the performance framework is a better tool for measuring accountability, the SCSC staff recommends that the commission approve this charter amendment request.
So we have a recommendation that the proposed charter amendment for CCAT to incorporate our performance framework as a measure of its accountability be approved. Can I have a motion and a second?
So moved.
Thank
second.
You. We have a motion and a second. Discussion or questions?
Easy today. Okay, I'll call for a vote. Then all those in favor of approving the recommendation, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed?
Aye.
Hearing none, the motion passes. All right, we are on to our next process item, which is charter amendment for the Ivy Preparatory Academies.
Yes, I don't think this one's going to be as little discussed as the previous. And before we get started, I just want to be very clear for the commissioners and for our audience about what this action is and what the commission's considering. The SCSC received a request from the three Ivy Prep Academies, Ivy Preparatory Academy at Gwinnett, Ivy Preparatory Academy at Kirkwood, and Ivy Preparatory Young Men's Academy. I'm going to collectively refer to them as the Ivy Prep Academy. They requested to reduce the grade spans that they are authorized to serve in their charter contracts so that they would not be out of compliance with their charter contracts given that the school board's decision to close their high school programs. The governing board has already decided to cease serving high school grades. That is a decision by the governing board, and I understand that that is going to take an effect at the end of this month, October. To be clear for the audience and for the commissioners, we do not have the authority to overturn that board action. It is within the sole authority of the school's governing board to maintain programs that are in compliance with their charter contracts. So if the contractual language remains as it is, the schools will be out of compliance with their charter contracts. That non-compliance would lead to greater monitoring by SCSC staff. It would affect the likelihood of renewal for those schools, but it would not reverse the board's decision to close the high school program if we did not approve the request to amend the charter contracts. In reading the request and reviewing the information and data provided by the school and obtained by SCSC staff, the high school programs are requesting this amendment due to the inability of the high school programs to adequately serve those students. While the school cited a lack of funding contributed to the quality of the program, SCSC staff did not consider the funding availability as a basis to support the request. Quite simply, all state charter schools could use additional funding, and a lack of resources is not an excuse for serving students. Therefore, in reviewing the information provided by the school and obtained by SCSC staff, we only reviewed and evaluated the request on the basis of academic options available to students. Given the past performance data as well as current data provided by the school, it was very clear that the schools were not serving students. A majority of the students were currently failing a large number of their courses. The high school options were some of the lowest performing options available in the county. Based on that information, SCSC staff believe that the students would be better served elsewhere, and we are supportive of this request to ensure that those students have access to better educational opportunities not provided by the schools. To be clear, I think we all sympathize with the students and parents who have had to move in the middle of the semester. We know and believe that the situation could have been handled more appropriately by all parties involved. But at the end of the day, sitting here, SCSC staff supports this request because we believe that the students would be better served in another educational option besides the high performing high schools. With that, I'm happy to answer any questions the commission has. We've got some staff school representatives that will also be happy to answer any questions that you have.
Thank you, Gregg. Just a reminder to commissioners, the procedure I'd recommended to you all, if you all are okay, is that we have a motion and a second. So that allows us to have discussion amongst ourselves to staff, whomever, if you want to ask questions. And then if you'll permit me, we'll do public comment on this issue only before we do a vote rather than at the end of the meeting. So with that, we have a staff recommendation to approve the requested amendment. Is there a motion and a second?
So moved.
I have a motion. Thank you. Motion and a second. We'll open it to discussion. And in the meantime, I'll ask Katie, can you look at the list and start helping me see how many we've got? All right, commissioners, I will open it up to you for discussion, questions, comments on this issue.
Well, I've got a couple of comments, and don't be afraid, I have points. I'm a good Presbyterian. We always have so many points to talk about, and sometimes we forget what the last one is, so I wrote some of them down. And I would say to those that are troubled by the decision, my first response to all of this, fellow commissioners, would it bothered me that they had made the decision before we had changed the charter. But then I found out through talking to Gregg and the staff that they didn't do this without consulting with our staff. They talked to the staff at the Board of Education. So that particular point became less of a troublesome issue for myself. And the second thought that comes to my mind is that even though I understand that this is obviously an emotional item, and if I had a child in that school, I would probably be emotional as well. But I think when you look at the performance, and when you look also at the number of students, that the decision, it's hard for me to see a good argument not to make that decision. With less than 90 students in three high schools, you know, that's just not a number that's viable, I don't think, to continue to carry a high school. So you add that to the lack of performance that has been shown, and I'm not sure which came first, the chicken or the egg. Having that few of students has got to limit the resources that can be used to teach them. So whether the limited resources is the problem or just the poor performance is the problem is really not an issue. The performance is there. And I don't think that questioning the actual decision is even disputable. The third thing, and I don't know her, but I want to express empathy to the new head of the school. My understanding is that she came to work a week before school started. And so I don't, Ms. Morgan, is that you? Okay. I don't think this is a problem of your doing, and I've read things in the media and heard people talk in the media like, you know, I didn't recognize you because I didn't see the tread marks for the buses in front of you. But I think that's a very unfair thing for those who have tried to put the blame on you. As a matter of fact, I suspect but don't know that you may be the one that alerted the board that we've got a problem that we've got to address, and it required action. So. My advice to the public is just to stop trying to make her the scapegoat. But then my last two points are not so conciliatory, and they're pretty much addressed to the governing board and to the former head of school, whoever that was. This is going to put a lot of hardship on the families, and I don't think that the decision can be avoided, but I do think that you should be held culpable for horrible timing in terms of doing this. I think fundamental governance of any school says that you've got a number, and you know what that number is, and that number is the number of students you've got to break even to be able to support that school. And you know well before the school starts whether you are above or below that number, and I've got to assume that, that number was much higher than the 85 to 90 students that you've got in the school now. So while you didn't create the pain, I would say that I think you should be held culpable for intensifying and increasing the pain, because this decision, to me, from my perspective, looks like it could have been made in July or August, and that's when it should have been made. Now, I do think it should have been made, but doing it now is just added to the pain that these students and these families are having to deal with. But then my final observation sort of goes to something that, that Gregg mentioned earlier. I've been reading and hearing people say, well, it's about funding. Well, that's sort of not an untruth, but I think that's a half-truth. The reason funding is so difficult is because this school and all charter schools get paid on a per-student basis. And when you've got this few of students, the total funding to support a high school program is obviously going to be inadequate. But I would argue that the limited funding is a result, not a cause of the problem. It's the poor performance that has caused you to be unable to attract enough students to make having an high school financially viable. So just to those who've been saying, we don't get funded enough. From my perspective, I hope the Education Reform Committee that's meeting gives more funds to charter schools. But there's a lot of charter schools that are taking this amount of funding per student and are making it work. And so to say, broadly say, well, this is a problem because charter schools don't get funded enough, I just want to publicly say that I disagree with that statement. And Madam Chairman, I just want to close by saying it's tempting to vote against this request, but to do so would punish the students in the lower grades that are still there, because it would place even more scrutiny on the school as it goes forward, and that's unfair to do that to the students from eighth grade and below because of the bad timing of a decision made for the high school. But also, it would prevent this school from going back into high school without coming back to us and being subject to our scrutiny. And I wouldn't want this school trying to open a high school again without us being able to consider, you know, the issues that are being looked at in order to do that. So I would just say to my fellow commissioners, I'm going to vote in favor of this and encourage you to do the same.
Thank you very much, Commissioner Williams. Very, very thoughtful comments.
Well said, Paul. Well said.
Other comments or questions from commissioners?
Yes, Madam Chair.
Commissioner Lowden?
I agree with a lot of what Paul has said today. As I've read about some of the things in the media, and I think about the kids that's at this school. I've had an opportunity to visit Ivory Prep schools, all three. And 2 years ago, we were sitting here talking about the three-year contract that we gave the boys and the emotion that was running high with that as well. My biggest concern, and I say this from a point of, I travel the state daily, and I'm in and out of prisons on behalf of my day-to-day job. And I see young men and women who are in our prisons, in our jails, because of turbo education. And it bothers me that we have decisions that adults make that could prevent some of the things that our kids are going through. This problem wasn't a yesterday problem. I know Ms. Morgan's here today. You've been running by several buses after you've taken this job. But I'm really concerned about the governing body of the school. I'm concerned that they don't have parents involved on the board. I'm concerned about how they're making decisions. And like Paul, I was tempted to vote against this as well, but it would put those kids, even the other kids, in a terrible situation as well. I hope that the governing board hear this loud and clear that, I don't know about the rest of my colleagues, but I'm not happy. That it seems like when we talk about kids and choice, all stakeholders should be at the table and we should make decisions in a vacuum. And it seems like to me it should be some parent involvement. It seems to me that all the policies and procedures that we set by this commission, they should be following. Getting audits on time. I mean, there's a lot of things that we could have prevented earlier on than where we are right now. And I hope that the parents, Dr. Morgan, those that are here today, go back and, if there's any board members here today, go back and, I'm not going to preach as a preacher, but loudly say my concerns of this governing board. That they should be attending governing training. There's no excuse for that. I hope that Terrence really look at that, and I hope that our staff really give them some letters of that you need to comply. Because you do have three schools that's coming back up for renewal. And I personally need to see some change and some better governing myself. I hope I didn't step outside the box, Madam Chair, but I am very, very, very upset with the fact that we take kids and move them mid-year, and then they get back into a system where returning to their schools that they come from, or the parents have to relocate. That being said, I believe that hopefully the parents and the kids are strong enough to make that adjustment. But it grieves me to see that we put our kids in a situation. We are better than that in this state. And we should demand that our governing boards treat our product better than that. That's all I have to say.
Thank you, Commissioner Lowden. I appreciate your
words. So I have a couple of questions. I don't know if the commission can answer these, but perhaps when public comment comes about, they can be answered. I have studied the materials that were provided to us and looked at some of the PowerPoint presentations, and I'm just wondering why, according to the timeline and the presentations we saw, this issue, the closure of the high schools, was beginning to be looked at in March of 2015. And I'm trying to understand why it took 7 months to close those high schools. Why, with such an important issue on the table, if you started looking at it in March, why that decision wasn't made in June or July before the August school year started? Because I think it is a huge disservice that these children have started high school and now have to move in the middle of the year, and that seems to me to be an adult problem, an adult issue. Why wasn't the process sped up for the sake of these children? And then I also want to know if there are any members of the board present. I understand that the vote of the board to close the high schools was 7-1, and I'm curious as to the one no vote, and if anyone knows what the reasoning was for that.
Commissioner Werner, if you'd like, we don't have to wait till public comment. We can ask Executive Director Morgan if there's somebody else to address your comments, and if you'd like to do that.
Yeah, that'd be great.
Good morning, commissioners and staff of the commission. I'm Alicia Morgan, the executive director of Ida Preparatory Academies. As was stated, I am new on this job. My first day on the job was the first day of our new scholars coming to Ida Preparatory Academies. And so I can certainly give you some background, but before I answer your question, but Ms. Werner, I first want to go on record to apologize to our scholars and to our parents who've been negatively affected by this very difficult decision. It is not taken lightly the damage, frankly, that we have caused as an organization on our scholars and the families because of this decision. What I can tell you in terms of the history of this, Ivy Prep has struggled with high school for a number of years. It didn't start in March. Frankly, because of what we have been able to produce over the last few years, particularly at our Gwinnett campus, there was a significant demand on behalf of our parents to continue this work into high school. And so I believe the board attempted to meet the request of the parents, understanding that funding was going to be an issue, but they tried a number of options. And so it started with a traditional high school model. Realized that because of enrollment, they were not going to have the dollars to provide the high quality options, and so decided to start a blended model. And it was clear, as you saw from the data that you've received, that academic performance continued to decline with all of the number of changes that were made. I have to say on behalf of the staff that they have been communicating with the board since the beginning that this model was not working. I can't speak for our chairman, who is the person who voted against closing high school, but he's been with the organization for a number of years and has close relationships with parents. And I would say he thought that he was responding to what parents really want. We have a close-knit family at IB, and we have served girls since they were in sixth grade in our Kirkwood campus since elementary school. And so you can imagine the family that you create and the quality that we have provided in elementary and middle school, that parents wanted that to continue. Our chairman is out of the country right now, and that's why he's not here today. And again, I don't want to speak for the board, but I can tell you that there are board members who are present today, in fact, who are much more engaged, much more involved, who have been a part of making this very difficult decision. Did I answer your questions?
You did on the board issue, the voting. As far as the study that started in March, can you speak to why the results only came out in September, why it wasn't really addressed in July?
The staff, the executive director at the time, Victoria Wiley, recommended to the board in March closure of high school. And the board decided not to accept that recommendation and directed the staff to go back yet another time to try to fix the model. You will notice in the documents that you received, letters from our staff, all of our academic staff, were very clear. And many, and you'll hear from them in public comment, they've been serving our scholars since sixth grade. And it pained them to have to make this decision early on and to try to get the board to act. But again, the board at the time did not accept that recommendation and directed the staff to go back and try to fix it. And again, they did. And there are a number of things that they tried. And so to get to your question, again, I arrived August 3rd. The first day of school was August 11th. And if I could just describe for you what it was like for me to walk into our high school, first of all, we did not have space at the Kirkwood campuses to accommodate high school, and so we were renting space from the YMCA across the street. I walked in and saw students who were on computers for 6 hours a day. At the time, they were using the Connexus platform. And full disclosure, not all of our students were enrolled on Connexus, and so you would have one student who was on the platform and another student who was sitting next to them who was not enrolled, and they were taking classes together. Not acceptable. We also had inadequate space at the YMCA, so you can imagine a high school experience of sitting in a classroom for 6 hours a day on a laptop. Frankly, we were not offering a blended model. We were offering an online model that happened to be in a brick and mortar building. In our Gwinnett campus, we had, let's say, 25 scholars in one classroom. The students who were receiving a social studies class, let's say it was three at a time, the teacher would direct instruction to those three while the other students remained on their laptops and earbuds. Again, not a conducive environment for a high quality education. And so the final straw was looking at the academic data. And when you see the product that we have provided out of middle school and then see that only 23% of our boys were passing one class or more, 50% of our girls in both schools were passing one class or more. We looked at the data from last year and the struggle that our students faced in graduating from high school, it was very clear that we cannot continue this model. And so I went to our academic committee, brought them in to experience this for themselves, and they brought then the recommendation to our full board to close high school. And so that is why it took until now to stop the high school program. And again, I just want to close by saying that I deeply regret that this decision had to be made. But when we're looking at on-time graduation for some very bright and talented students, we could not wait one more day and get in the way and jeopardize on-time graduation for our scholars. And while it was the most difficult decision we'll probably ever make as an organization, it was absolutely the best thing to do for our scholars.
And this, I have two questions. Tears, we know that they were renting the YMCA. Ms. Morgan, how long have they been renting the YMCA?
I think just this school year. I'm not sure. I'll have to get back to you with the correct answer on that.
Is there a board member here that can answer that question?
2 years.
I'm not a board member, but we were in the building last year.
So two school years.
We had space in the build, in the Kirkwood building as well as the lot.
What was said, just in case no one heard, that we were renting space from the YMCA as well as having high school within the Kirkwood building. This year, all of high school for Kirkwood was in the YMCA.
Madam Chair, stuff like that really kicks me in the gut. Terrence, how many have their board members attended all of the governance trainings and been in compliance with all of the trainings that we've offered, what is required of them?
I can answer that. They did send the majority of their board to our training last year. I believe that their board chair did not attend our training last year, which was required. And just as a reminder, this year we are offering the option for them, for all boards, to receive training from an alternate provider if they can't make it to our training, so that they can meet that requirement.
Is the Charter School Association working with this board at all?
Not directly with the board. I certainly communicate with them on a regular basis. I do know that the training that's coming up in November, that our board members are expected to attend.
Commissioner Lowden, are you thinking that that kind of decision was something they should have alerted us, the authorizer, to, or what? Tell me more.
The reason I'm saying that is because we have these babies and we're using taxpayer dollars and they're arbitrarily moving the school, although they're not moving the school that's been approved by the state where the kids should be housed. But they're taking this high school and put them into a YMCA. And there's all kinds of problems, I believe, that can happen with that. That we should at least our staff, they should let our staff know about that. I'm just concerned that do this board have the capacity to make the right decisions? And
I think that's something we'll definitely take up as each of their schools come for renewal. And I think the first one is coming up this year.
Yes, I regret the young men's, as we heard Morgan say, their final day of the charter contract is June 30th next year, and we'll begin the review process in the next month or so.
If I may add, Madam Chair, perhaps part of the reason that the YMCA was being used, not perhaps, but I'm positive that it was, as a part of our bond that we just completed at Kirkwood Girls School, the plan was to build additional space to accommodate high school, and so the YMCA was a temporary space while that building was happening.
Thank you. So you're not doing that anymore?
We are going to expand, but based on the decision that's made today, we will focus on expanding our elementary and middle school programs.
Are you working with our staff? Is that allowable within the charter to expand elementary and middle?
Yes.
And I would note that we have waiting lists in our Kirkwood schools, and so it's certainly an opportunity for us to, again, provide the high quality education that we can, and we know that we can provide at the elementary and middle school levels.
Commissioner Hall?
I have a comment. 34 years experience in education. And basically, one of my philosophies in education is you got to deal with facts, not emotion. And I feel like that looking at the results that's presented to us, I feel like that we must do what's right for the students. And what's right for the students, they're not getting the quality education that they should be, evidenced by the number that's not passing. I feel like this decision should be based on the fact that we've got to do what's right for the students. And we got a lot of microphones. Yes, I haven't been heard. But I do feel like that if these students are failing now in order, and if they continue to fail, then we're holding those students back. We should give them an opportunity to move on elsewhere. So that's my feeling. I agree with most of the comments that the commissioners have made. But here again, we've got to do what's right for the students. Thank you.
Thank you, Commissioner Hogg. Sorry, we wanted to make sure your words of wisdom were heard, and it looks like all of them went out at the same time. All the Commissioner Werner?
I recognize that this answer calls for pure speculation, but have you heard rumblings from your board that if this amendment was not approved, they might want to revisit things and reopen high school in the 2016-2017 school year?
You're right, it is speculation. What I am comfortable saying is there is, let me say this about the board. It's not a secret that we've had a challenge in terms of our governing board. What I can say though is that the last less than 3 months that I have been the executive director, that they have become much more engaged, much more communicative. I am on the phone communicating with at least two or three board members on a daily basis. And so I think that you will find in the next few months, especially as they are in a recruiting phase, that you will have a much more engaged board that's paying attention, that's making good decisions. What I do know about high school is that, again, because of the demand from parents, there are members of the board who want to entertain that conversation. I also know, though, that based on the recommendations of our staff, that's been around for a while with a tremendous amount of expertise, that it's not something that we would recommend. And so in January, when the board has a strategic planning meeting, I expect that that will be a part of the agenda where we will make a hard decision about where we need to focus our efforts as an organization, K through 12.
Okay. Other comments or questions from commissioners? Hearing none, thank you, Executive Director. Morgan, Ms. Morgan, Alicia, I appreciate it being on the hot seat for a little bit. We'll go ahead and do public comment. We have 14 people signed up. So that means we're going to limit it. Traditionally, we do 3 minutes. We'll limit it to about 2 or so minutes per person. And again, if you'll keep in mind the decision that's before us. And also, I guess one of the things I'd be interested to hear from parents is, given the academic data that we have seen, why you might fight to keep your child in that school, if that is part of your public comment and wanting us and advocating for that. So with that, I will just go down the list as people have signed up. The first one is Priscilla Dixon.
She just went to the ladies' room.
Okay. Jeannie McCree.
That's me.
And if you'll come to the podium, please, and let us know your affiliation with Ivy Prep. And who is keeping time on our board? Ms. Phelps is going to keep time, so she will let you know when we're at time.
It'll be quick.
And Ms. Rippner, may I just remind everybody of the comment that Gregg made earlier, is that we are not here considering whether to overrule their decision and tell them to go back and open the high school. So that's off the table, so it would be a waste of your precious small amount of time to revisit that whole issue right now. So.
All right, Ms.
McCree,
if you'll tell us your affiliation, then you have the floor.
Okay, my name is Jeannie McCree. I have two affiliations with Ivy Preparatory Academies. My first affiliation is that I am the parental involvement coordinator for the girls' school. I came into Ivy Prep at the very beginning, 2011, as your parental involvement coordinator. This past year, I also took on another role of being the guardian of my great nephew, who was in the high school program. So I just want to speak from both ends. As his guardian, he was in a traditional high school that was not serving him properly. He had an IEP, was not serving him properly. So I did bring him to Ivy Prep because I did like the Connections program. I liked what I saw. I liked what I thought would be happening for him. But unfortunately, it did not work for him. And when we started with the new program this year, which was the GVAX, he just completely was lost. There was no help for him, the blended model in which he needed when he first got there. It was, as somebody, as our executive director stated, it was the Connexus model, which he did not have because that came from last year, students from last year. So he had to sit for a month with another student and try to learn that way, and it did not help him at all. But I'm happy to say that since the closing, he has gone into a traditional high school, and he has caught on very well, in which I have spoken to his math teacher, and his other math teacher is here today, that he came in last night with homework about trigonometry. And he was able to sit down from that blended model, I mean, from just the high school that he had, the people that were there helping him, he had a counselor with him, his special ed coordinator. He came in and was able to do the trigonometry by himself. And so he said to me, this is a real school, and I don't want to work on another computer. So that's coming from a 15-year-old, you know, in a world of technology, we could have turned him away from technology altogether. Just by the program that we had. And so from that parent perspective, I'm very happy with the decision.
Ma'am.
I'm thankful to our executive director. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Again, I'm sorry about the time limit, but it's a lot of you. We'll move back up. Priscilla Dixon. That's okay. You might not have heard it. You'll just tell us your affiliation with the school that you have about 2 minutes.
Let's see, good morning. My name is Priscilla Dixon. I am a middle school math teacher. And the only thing I like to share is that after observing the initial year for the high school, I was not comfortable recommending that my girls attend. I'd served them for 3 years as a mathematics teacher. I know what I invested in them, and I could not see that go to waste. We had previous students coming back asking me, Ms. Dixon, can you tutor me? I'm having difficulties. And when I saw what they were working on, it did not align with what I'd seen in high school, having taught high school. And so with what I saw and what I've been asked to do, I could not recommend that my girls go. That's all I can say.
Thank you very much. Anyone else?
Okay.
Billy, is it Manice?
Manice.
Good morning, I'm Billy Manise. I was actually hired in the middle of August as the high school math teacher for the Kirkwood campus, serving both the girls and the boys, YA. So I have a few things I want to look at. We actually started the process of collecting data. And in collecting data, I was actually looking at the high school students that we had served. And the data for the CRCT showed that they were either meeting or exceeding the expectations. Those same students were also failing in Georgia Virtual, showing that that model was not working for that particular student. They needed a conversation, they needed a live teacher, they needed traditional high school. I actually took my class, which was the Georgia Virtual. I was hired to actually be more of a monitor. I took my class and took it offline and made the class, the online, their homework portion. And I started to see their engagement and their understanding increase as a person who has taught high school for many years and also has done some writing for Smarter Balance, the Common Core testing. So in that, I have to support that this is not a good model. And I actually took that and I actually applied it in my class. So my class now became a traditional class. And then the students were looking at, what can we do? We just want you to teach us. So with that being said, just with the resources that are available, I can't say that I think that Ivy Prep, and I'm going into helping the middle school out in many ways, I don't think that Ivy Prep would be the best option. For one, money, because I know all the variables that it is to have a high school operating properly. And that's why I can say that most charter schools do not have high school programs because they have so many variables to educate the students properly for a graduation program that is geared towards preparing you for higher learning. And that's why I cannot set boards. IB prep being responsible or even looking into high school ever. I think that it should stay with middle school and elementary, where it's best successful. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Cheryl Treadwell?
Good morning.
Good morning.
I'm a member of the governing board. My name is Cheryl Treadwell. I've been on the board for less than a year. And when I came in today, I helped put together the packet that you received in the correspondence. And maybe it's because I'm a lawyer, but I thought I was going to regurgitate what was in there. But I think you understand where we're coming from on the academic piece. What I wanted to respond to was the comments that I heard from the commissioners about the governing board. And to that, I say the tracks should have been on us and not this morning. And I take responsibility for the part that we had in the timing. Those were adult factors or adult decisions, because I believe you're right about July, but there were other issues, what we'll call adult issues, that prevented it from happening in March or prior to that. And I make no excuses for that, but I do apologize to the families who've been affected. But at the end of the day, our decision was based on the academics. For me, I'm not an officer, I'm not a chair. When the alarm sounded, I had to act. It was urgent. And that's why we made the decision that we did.
Thank you for your comments and your honesty. We appreciate it. Stacy Bonney?
Bonney.
Stacy Fani. I am the network director of high school programs for all three of the Ivy Prep high schools. I'm only going to address a portion of my comments to the high school because I do actually want to say something about the amendment that is before you today. But I do want to just reiterate that I do agree that the timing of this was poor, and that's not even the appropriate word. I don't know that there really is a word to describe it. And from a school leadership perspective, we've been recommending that our board really take into serious consideration our high school program. Because as the network director, I look at the data every week. And so when this school year started and school leadership saw that, yet again, our scholars are starting to have this same trend. Our principal sounded the alarm, and thankfully this time someone actually, you know, acted on it. The timing is terrible, but we love our scholars. But we really couldn't, another semester in a program that's less than quality, I wasn't comfortable with. So I'm glad that higher leadership actually did heed our call. But I just want you to know that this has been a conversation from school leadership for several years to take some action other than what has been taken. I want to talk about the strength of our middle school. We have a phenomenal middle school program. I'm speaking particularly at Gwinnett, and I've also had a daughter go through the program. All the time we have parents who come back and say they're great, they're exceeding their scholars. We have other educators who can identify Ivy Prep scholars. So I would hate to see the tragedy of the high school program negatively impact our middle school program, because it is a phenomenal program and people recognize our scholars for their excellence. So I just hope that you consider that when you make your vote.
Thank you very much for your comments. Jennifer Falk.
Morning, commissioners.
Good morning.
You really need someplace to set your notes on this.
So my affiliation with Ivy Prep, I probably have been a supporter of Ivy Prep Academy longer than anybody sitting in this room. I can date this back down to 2005, 2006. So that's my affiliation. The affiliation started when a young girl who was sent to alternative schools through Gwinnett County Public Schools was killed trying to cross the street to receive transportation in MARTA to attend the alternative school. Ivy Prep was born of that story. Ivy Prep was also born of the story where students were sent to alternative schools, and if they got in trouble there, they were sent out into the community for 6 weeks to clean offices. That's how Ivy Prep was born. That's how I started my affiliation. Charter schools are all about parent choice, and I have never seen a more horrific example of parent choice being ripped from parents, not 3 years ago, yes, 3 years ago, and also as early as yesterday. The actions that have been taken by the board and by the current staff completely diminish everything that you stand for, everything that you're in here for, which is supporting parent choice. If parents don't want their children in the high schools because they're reviewing the academic material, they have the option to move. By you negating the obligations of all of these adult decision makers and their charter, you are part of the issue. You are ripping parent choice away from parents. These are adult decisions that have been made as far as 3 years ago, as far as today. You can send a message back to this school to say, go back and educate your kids by not amending your charter. I'll very quickly take you back to 2011 when your number one charter school in Georgia, Gwinnett Math and Science, was accused of creaming students, requiring additional information before acceptance, accused of not serving students with special education, which I just heard a few moments ago was apparently being done at Ivy Prep, not serving students with ESOL. And instead of amending a charter, and what they, excuse me, can I just finish this sentence? What the Georgia Department of Education did is they sent a letter to Gwinnett County Schools and said, you will abide by your charter obligations, period. And now look at what's happened. The interventions that were put in place for children going into that school were intensified. You have the opportunity to vote not to amend the charter, and I would encourage you to follow your gut, because many of you are sitting here knowing that that's the right thing to do. Thank you.
I just got a text. They're stuck in the elevator. Those three people. The elevator's stuck and someone's passed out. So I don't know. I'm just going to go outside.
Okay.
I'm sorry.
No, please do.
Hi. Sorry. My name is Sarah Joyce. I have three children that were out of prep. I had a graduating senior that I just had to pull out of Ivy Prep and place it to another school. I have two children in middle school. I agree with you, Mr. Williams, and I agree with you, Mr. Lowden, about the school. The school is not performing correctly. If it's not performing, it's not helping the children. I agree with that. I have no problem with that. My problem is the way it was done. And I voiced this to the board more than once. My child's senior year is ruined. She took her senior pictures for Ivy Prep on September 28th. I got a call September 30th from her telling me the high school was closing. Minutes before that, actually, I had got a letter from the principal saying that there was a very important letter coming home. And then I'm like, okay, this is the letter that he was talking about. Then about 30 minutes or 45 minutes, I got a letter saying the actual school was closing and the board had voted. But on October 22nd, I attended a board meeting. They voted then. I believe they put the cart before the horse. I know they did. I don't know what the reason was, because to me, it's all been lies. I have taken my daughter when I went to transfer her to Norcross. They had told my daughter, nobody told me, because I'm not necessarily going on what they're saying or going on what I see in facts. I took my daughter to register and they said, oh, don't worry about it. Georgia Connects, virtual grades, because they're not gonna look at them. And my daughter's like, and I told my daughter, I said, stay on top of your Georgia virtual for your grades, because your grades gonna transfer. She said, no, they told me not to. Okay. Bella's first thing she did was pull my daughter's Georgia virtual grade and not Connexus. And actually that day, the same day, I got an email saying that my daughter has not been online for Georgia virtual. And I'm like, I'm sorry, I just rolled my daughter in, they're closing the hospital. I have heard more sympathy from you than I have from the school, the board members, the executive director. I mentioned that my daughter is one of the ones that was in the video.
Yes.
I mentioned that.
Sorry.
Okay. All right. Thank you. Just wanted to give my point.
Thank you for your comments. Chaz Pattinson?
Good morning. My name is Chaz Patterson. I am the newly appointed principal at Ivy Preparatory Academy, Gwinnett. I have served at Ivy Prep as a school teacher in 2009, and then I moved into the role of assistant principal, and I'm in the role of principal. So I started at Ivy Prep as the role of a teacher, where I've done that starting in 2009, moving to the role of assistant principal, where I served in that role for 4 years, and then I moved into the principal role. As you've already heard, we have presented this information to the board in recommendation to close high school since 2011. Each year it was denied from our executive director and guidance of the board. So there's been some shifts and changes in the board, and I am confident to say now that our board is moving in the right direction, making sure that they make hard decisions. One thing for me was coming into this school year, knowing the data, that we had to make a change. Just as I have taught all of the girls that are in high school, even the ones who graduated last year and moving into graduation this year, they were in my class. So it was very important for me that they receive the education that they deserve. Going back to the data, I like to speak numbers. Ivy Prep's SAT average was 1204, and we definitely know the highest that they can receive is 2400. So with that, they're not performing well there. I just received our latest EOC milestones results for end of grade. And there are 6 beginning learners in economics and 2 developing learners that we've had. And that's of 8 that took that test. Biology, we have 2 beginning learners, 1 beginning learner in geometry, 3 beginning learners in algebra. And that's a huge concern for me, making sure that we do what we need to do, especially when I look at the performance framework that you're making sure that I hold myself accountable to in the school. I'm looking at the academic performance and achievement, making sure that we're fiscally responsible and operating a high school program in the way that we're operating it now, just to make it work, is not being fiscally responsible when it comes down to the framework that you've set forth. So please know that this was a decision that was very hard for us as a school, but I always had to make sure that I'm doing what's best for the girls. And I know that our families and the timing was very, very off. And it was if it was up to me, the decision would have been made back in 2011, but at that time I was just an assistant principal. I'm not being able to make those decisions. So we had to make a decision. This is a decision, and hopefully that the parents and I look forward to our girls succeeding in their traditional high schools, but I definitely want to convey to you and all of the community members that the quality of education that we provide in high school will not benefit them to get to the colleges or universities of their choice, which goes back to our mission. So thank you so much. Have a great day.
Thank you very much.
Marlon, Maryland, tell me. So always go with your gut, it's Marlon.
So my affiliation with Ivy Prep, I'm an early supporter. And I'm not a charter school supporter, but I am a supporter of Ivy Prep. I think charters have a place in education. I just don't think the proliferation of them has a place in education, in public education. And I organize parents around education advocacy. Charters are supposed to be a better option for parents, giving them a choice, giving them the quote unquote better education. What is happening right now is why I'm not a holistic supporter of charter schools. And I can support Ivy Prep because from what I've seen thus far, they've been a real education option that was needed. So here's my issues with what's going on right now. This whole situation shines a light on the lack of policies and accountabilities that a charter model does not have. No transparency in decision making. You heard the parents say they were told the board voted, the board didn't vote till some other days later. No parent involvement. This board doesn't require that. This board should require that within your policies and practices. And Georgia has a model called local school council. You should require that. That's a parent advisory board for the school. You should require that every charter school has a local school council. No policies in place by this board to keep schools from closing after counts, funding counts. I think the timing is curious. No policies in place by this board or their governing board to keep schools from closing in the middle of a semester. Who does that? A traditional public school does not do that. I think there could have been something done with their model to make it to the end of the year. First of all, you're turning kids out at a point that they can't get permissive transfers. They cannot get into private institutions. It's a very difficult task. I'm working with a parent trying to help them through that process. I'm in 2 minutes. Well, let me just say one last final thing. This is just a perfunctory process because you all said you don't have the power to overturn it. And I know there's no policy in place to mete out any consequences if they weren't in compliance. So if parents have a real choice, they need to have an accountability choice as well. And as a taxpayer, that's what I want.
Thank you. If you could not do that, please. We're going to keep this as professional as possible. Joyasha Vaughn?
I decline.
Okay. Tolton Pace? I believe this is our last one. And then if anyone has an update on the folks in the elevator, I'd love to hear it.
Good morning to the commission. My name is Tolton Pace, and I'm one of the board members at Ivy Prep. I joined the board in the spring of this year, so just prior to the end of the school year, so still fairly new. But in that newness, we did receive, of course, the information that you heard about the potential to close high school and what that could look like and what that means from our staff people. There were a number of recommendations made. I can stand here and say that I caused much resistance, asked lots of questions about our high school program, in addition to a number of other things, including operations as it relates to our networking of schools. And so since that time, I saw that one of the ways to kind of make a bigger difference and advocate for more change was to begin to get involved in many of the committees that the board has. And so as a result of that, I decided that I wanted to get onto the academic committee, and I'm actually the academic committee chair at this point, who made the recommendation to actually close the high school when we did. And again, it was a process that we had to get to. It couldn't happen right away, unfortunately, because there was much resistance from existing board members. Just to give you a little perspective, when I joined in the spring, there were 11 members that made up the board. Shortly thereafter, we had one member to resign, which left us with 10. At this point, we've currently had about 3 board members to resign, which will be effective as of November 1st. So now we're down to about 7 board members, but again, in the process of active recruitment as well. And so what I can also say is that based on the makeup of the current board, about half of the board has been on the board probably a year or less. So most of the members of the board are fairly new still, and so I hope that what you'll begin to see is some very informed decision making. Again, we don't agree with the timing, what happened recently, we agree with that, and unfortunately it went down the way that it did, and we apologize for that. But again, we felt that we could not continue to build the plane while flying it at the same time. And so with that, again, we hope that you'll see some more informed decision making. We hope that you'll see lots of questions asked. We hope that you'll see us moving in a new direction in light of us having a new executive director at this point, making some administrative changes and organizational changes as well. And again, we just hope that progress will be seen and that you'll begin to see the light at the end of the tunnel with us as well. I'm an educator. I'm also a youth minister as well. And so this is definitely near and dear to my heart. This is not some arbitrary position that I decided to take just because it would look good on a resume. And I'm also a father as well. And so this is not something I take lightly. I've been involved in the community for many, many years. And if I could say last but not least, with respect to this decision in particular, I've also had the opportunity to serve as an assistant dean of admissions at Emory for several years. And so looking at the data that we received from our leadership team and our staff, and I put my Emory hat on and sat to look at an admissions file of our Ivy Prep scholars and said, we cannot continue to do this to our students. There's no way that I could admit these students into Emory. Thank you. Appreciate the opportunity.
Thank you very much.
Can we ask questions?
Sure.
Can you come back?
I think Commissioner Werner and Lowden have some questions.
Sure.
So I think early on, Commissioner Lowden expressed his disappointment in the board, and you've now just told us that you've lost three more members, and I think you're at seven. I should know the answer to this question, and I apologize because I don't. Does their charter contract require a certain number of board members?
You should know the answer. That's a lot of detail.
It does not.
No. It does not. Okay. Well, not in violation of that. But I'm concerned that you're leading board members and you're in control of the school, and you're actively recruiting. Do you have any leads? Like, can you speak to the building back up of the board?
Sure, yes, and also our governance committee person as well, Ms. Treadwell, can speak to that also. They're actually in charge of that process for the board. But we have several leads. I can say we have at least 10 individuals that have been recommended to serve on the board. And so at last update from the governance committee, we're in the process of screening resumes and having conversations and interviews with those potential candidates. And so our goal is to have those people in place by our next board meeting for November. One, so that they potentially get a preview and have some training as to what is involved in the board. Of course, receive bylaws, all those kinds of things, but we wanted to get them in place with all due haste as soon as possible. Of course, we did not anticipate the resignations that we have received from these three board members. Two of them are effective as of about 2 weeks ago. The other will be effective as of November 1st, which accounts for the three. So we're moving with all due haste to try to fill those positions that were vacated, but then also add up to three members as well to that board.
Okay. I would suggest that you make this a top priority and understand the urgency with which you need to fill out.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you, Commissioner.
Ms. Treadwell, administrator for both board members. First of all, I want to apologize for maybe kicking you in the shins, but I'm very passionate about our children and our state. Are you looking at recruiting parents to be a part of this board as well?
Yes. Our bylaws currently do not allow that, but as our governance chair resigned, I assume I will take her place as the new governance chair. I plan to recommend that. We do allow parents to serve, and if not in that capacity, then at the committee level capacity. Once we explain, you know, the commitments and everything, I think we would be able to get a parental involvement, whether at the board level or the committee level. And we are committed to, as you said, filling out the board, not just numbers, but with the right people. You know, as you said, we are relatively new to the board, but even though we're new, we have seen the shift, and we are committed to making sure that we find the right people, working through with our connections and the various board banks. And also, I was taking notes from every individual commissioner's comments, and I fully intend, again, I'm not the chair, but I intend to make sure the board gets the message loud and clear. I took notes on everything. That training to decision making, and we will communicate that. And
say this because I'm a visual learner, and I'll try to project my voice because my microphones weren't dead. We took a tour of the school. When was that, Madam Chair?
2 months ago,
and
our mics are going out. I guess the batteries are failing.
I'll try to use my preacher voice. Or how's that? We took a tour of your school 2 months ago, and I loved what I saw until I went into one of the classrooms where there was all boys, and the teacher was doing a good job of calling on these young men to read a problem. And then when she got to this one particular boy that I can't get out of my head, it's been 2 months, every day I think about this little boy, he cannot read three-letter words. And that bothered me. And when I look at, we talking about these adults' decisions, this is a decision that your chair, comes from leadership, should be visiting these schools. I don't know how any governing board can make a decision from being out of the country or out of the state without seeing these children, these babies. Because if I was on that board and I saw our babies in the YMCA or sitting behind 6 hours in a computer, I would sound an alarm way back in 2011 and said, we're gonna close this. We close restaurants like at 69. Restaurants. So surely we should close schools that get a 69. So here's an opportunity to try to get it right. And I would hope, I know Ms. Morgan know what little boy I'm talking about. She was in that room. It broke my heart because the data says, since we're data driven, if a child can't read by third grade, he's going to enter into our prison system at some point of his life. And I hope and pray that we come up with some intervention for that little boy and all the other boys in that school. Because if not, we'll be here a year again, and I'll be saying that this school has a 69, and I would have to be the first commissioner to say, we have to close that school. So I apologize for kicking you in the gut today, but I'm unapologetic about our kids and their state.
And just a reminder, commissioners, you can ask questions of any person who did public comment.
I have one thing to say. Your daughter is very articulate. I'm not a Twitter person, but I ended up with a tweet and my message with this video of 12 minutes watching your daughter talk about her stay at Ivory Prep. And you tell her that myself, and I know the other commissioners feel the same way, that if she put her mind to it and the way she articulated herself about her situation, she can make it anywhere. It's not where you start, it's where you finish. And so please let her know that I said that I'm very proud of her, and I'm sorry that this interruption, but it could be a testimony later on in her life. Maybe she'll write a book about it. And there's a book that Dr. Knapp has called, that he wrote, that he was also on that link that was sent out called Tough Choices for Tough Times. Maybe the board maybe need to get together and have a retreat and read that book.
Thank you, Commissioner Loudon.
This is kind of like the earlier question to Ms. Morgan. Somebody asked a question to Ms. Morgan earlier that said it's going to require speculation. This is going to require a subjective, speculative answer. But I'm hearing that the bulk of your board has been on the board for less than a year. I'm hearing that you got brand new leadership. How long was the last executive director on board, Ms. Morgan?
2 years.
Okay, well, my instinct is this, and tell me if I'm oversimplifying it. It seems like in search of a scapegoat, people are jumping on a new executive director, relatively new board, and my observation is that prior executive directors, prior boards have created a mess, and now the people that are trying to correct it or catching the grief. And I'd just like an opinion from all three of you. Have I missed the mark in some way on that observation? Well, then the last thing I would add, I'm sorry I'm talking too much, and that is to the people that oppose this this decision, I think the results make it inevitable, and it appears that it may have gone, it may have been done about the right way, but in terms of our children, if we keep looking for scapegoats and keep claiming victimhood because we've been done wrong, that's not going to help the children that are now having to adjust to a new school, a new environment, a new set of circumstances. And I would just hope that we could put our emotions to the side as much as possible and focus completely on helping these children adjust to the new circumstances they've got to deal with now.
Other comments from commissioners?
I'm definitely
talking
too much.
But you've never spoken before.
It's just a sign.
It gets you up.
And I think this question is probably more for Ms. Morgan, if you want to come on. Thank you for sharing.
Could you two stay?
I don't believe it's our job to micromanage you, and I don't want to, but from what I have seen in the media, there has been a lot of misinformation out there to those most important, the parents and the students. Are there plans for more meetings with your parents of high schoolers or more communications to help them better understand the data that we've seen, or maybe that's already been presented? But what is sort of the plan going forward? I know you said the school's, the last day is October 30th. Are there any students still attending?
Yes, if I could give a little bit of history, again, because this is important for public record. We had our first set of parent meetings in September to talk to parents about the challenges that we were facing in high school. We had two meetings. It was not well attended, but we did offer those opportunities and express, again, to our parents what was happening. When the decision was made by the board, we then communicated to parents through a letter inviting them to three meetings. We hosted those meetings. At the beginning, we went through exactly the data that we've been talking about. Went through trending data, their current grades without talking about specific students, gave the entire history. So all the information that you have seen was provided to all parents that attended meetings, and again, were invited to three different meetings. We also, during those times, provided one-on-one sessions with parents to counsel them through this process. We had DeKalb County Schools present, allow parents to complete transfer forms on site. They were taken with them to DeKalb County Schools and began the transferring process the following day. Every parent at our Kirkwood Girls School was contacted by phone by our principal to make them aware of the situation and to provide any details. We also provided communication via email and phone calls to parents, and continuing to do so as late as yesterday, providing individual support to parents, ensuring that they have every support that they need. We have also created a full-time transition coordinator who checks in with students every 30 days and will continue to do so through the rest of the school year. We've also provided academic support. You met one of our math instructors who will continue to be on hand for the rest of the school year to provide math support. We also have another teacher who's providing English language arts support. We are also providing SAT and ACT prep through the rest of the school year, as well as college counseling for the rest of the school year. We've also created an alumni program, or refashioned our alumni program, to stay with these scholars until they get to and through college. Every opportunity that we have had to communicate with parents about this process, about the decision making, and the resources that are available to them have been communicated through a number of channels. And we continue to have our staff available to answer any questions.
Thank you.
Madam Chair.
Alicia, I love that plan of reaching out to those parents and those kids at that particular time. Is there a plan to shore up and or rest the concerns of the parents that are in kindergarten through eighth grade that are looking to, or were looking to move their kids into your high school, but now there's no high school, to ease their comfort that the school itself is not going to close?
Yeah, that's one of the hardest parts. Again, our parents love Ivy, and we've heard from a number of parents, their dream was to send them to Ivy from K to 12. And so we've been communicating with parents. We've not done the same level of communication in our K through 8 parents. We're having an event on November 18th, and we will talk about some of that, but it's to talk about the future of our organization. We understand that this is a demand that parents have, but we are absolutely committed to providing a quality product, and we are not going to provide a high school program until we know, number one, that we should be, and number two, if the board decides again that we will reopen high school and it is approved based on what happens today, that it'll be a quality product. Again, we will continue to communicate. All parents have been notified. We have made it very clear that our K through 8 programs are not impacted by this high school decision, and that we'll continue to bolster our current program so that our K through 8 schools provide the high quality education we know we're capable of.
I believe you're the right person for the job to get this done, to turn this around, and also to help the K through 8 program.
Thank
I
you.
Hope that you get the right support and the right people on the board that have the capacity so that you can lead. That's going to be crucial. But keep in mind, there will be those that stand beside you that will attack you in your back and not attack you face to face. And as the commissioner said earlier, Paul said that, you know, you get run over by buses. But, you know, when I first met you, I called you Rosa Parks because of the hits that you took for carrying the legislation for charter school. You're going to take those hits, and you're going to get run over by the bus. But if you are unapologetic about our kids' future in this state, take the hits because it's worth it.
Yes, sir. Thank you.
Excuse me, can I ask a question?
If it's really quick, that's out of procedure.
Some of the things that the executive director is stating about the children, I have not any knowledge of helping the children. In fact, I got off the phone on my way here with a parent that's having problems trying to get her daughter into school. She's went to 3 separate schools to get her into it.
We'll just urge the administration to further work with the parents.
Okay.
Please. All right. The only comments that I will add to the discussion is to thank the leadership of Gwinnett County Schools, DeKalb County Schools, and the Georgia Virtual Schools in helping to further this. Yes, if you'd like to sit down. Sorry. Thank you for helping with this transition of getting students into the right venue. I think listening to all this, I echo all the comments of my fellow commissioners and their questions. I think perhaps we could have done a better on communications, and hopefully going forward we will work to do a better job of that and make sure the students know what's going on, and parents, and really the priority of getting them into the right school right now. But I think I need to clarify, the mission of this commission is to open and support schools that have a better student achievement or provide a better educational opportunity for students than they otherwise would have. And so I think that means that primarily we are for student achievement, and secondarily we are for parental choice. If the student achievement is not there, in this instance, clearly is not there, hasn't been there, that is our first line of business. The beauty of charter schools is that if we see that's not happening, then we close that school or the portion of a school. In a traditional school, there's continued turnaround efforts, and we know from experience years, decades, that those often are not successful. The last thing I would say is I caution charter school supporters that you will use this or have used this and will use this as a red herring for charter school financial issues. As my fellow commissioners and our acting director have said, this is an academic issue. We all know that charter schools need more financial money, but that is not the crux of this issue. And I would urge that charter school supporters don't use this as a financial issue to talk about charter school finances and obscure what the real issue is, which is academics. With that, I'll ask for any final comments from commissioners.
No, hearing none, I will call the question. Forgive me, Chairman Rippner, may I have 1 minute, please?
Did you sign up for public comment?
I apologize, I did not. However, Commissioner Lowden called me out. I'm the person who tweeted him the video, and I just wanted to make a comment that I had attended one of the 3 meetings, and I brought my camera to film the meeting, and I was told I could not video record the meeting.
Okay.
And when they closed the meeting, I pulled out my camera, and that's when I made the film of the interview with the student and her parent. But it just seemed like it was clouded in secrecy because they would not allow my video recorder to record their meeting. That's all I wanted to comment.
Okay.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
reminder, all those in favor of this approving the recommendation from staff, which is to approve the amendment that Ivy Preparatory Academy, all three of them, shall be not serve high school. I'm going to go ahead and shorten that. Please say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed? Hearing none, the motion passes unanimously. And I would just further urge the staff and the board of Ivy Prep to reach out to parents, work with them on this, and also consider the longer-term issue of parental involvement communications as you go forward in reorganizing and developing your board and staff. Thank you for everyone who had contributed to this discussion, not only today in the form of public comment, but in the way of letters and emails, which we received each of them and had the opportunity to read all of them. And commissioners for putting in a lot of time on this issue as we initially got notice and as we worked through this and preparing for today. I really do thank you all for the time and effort, and we're committed to helping you, Ivy Prep, move on from this and remain strong in your elementary and middle grades. Anything else, Gregg, from your side?
At this point, I have to come up with something because I've paused too long.
Now you're fine. If
but
you're not.
I do want to reiterate that staff is here, not only for the Ivy Prep staff and board to help move the school in the right direction, but for parents and other stakeholders as well. We'll do whatever we can to help. It might not be much, but we're there to help you out. So just please, our contact information is on our website. I'll be happy to do whatever I can.
Any additional items from commissioners? We did not have any other public comment besides that we already had on Ivy Prep. And we have our last meeting of the 2015 calendar year in November.
Yes.
Okay. So we will see you all then. And
if I may, to be clear, it's not on our usual day. It's on, because that would be the third Wednesday before Thanksgiving. It's the one up. So, it's on our website again for the stakeholders, but in close contact with the commission on that.
So we're not having turkey.
I'll bring some turkey for you.
And we will have Dr. Holliday back at our next meeting. And I like to say publicly thanking Gregg for all of his work and staff. I know you've all pitched in as Dr. Holliday has been on her maternity leave, and you have done a fabulous job. I know it's not always been fun or what you had expected or wanted, but you all have done great, and I know you'll continue to do so for the last few weeks.
Sure, thank you.
That we work. Yeah. All right, so with that, I will adjourn the meeting. Thank you.
Did you want an update on the people
yes,
that were trapped in the elevator? Yeah.
They're at Grady Hospital.
What happened?
So one of them passed out, and the elevator was stuck, and 911 was called, and they're now at Grady Hospital.
So they passed out because
one
elevator
passed out. I mean, I don't know why she passed out.
Jennifer, can you keep me updated? I want to make sure that.
You're coming along, you got, yeah, that's almost.
How are you?
How are you?
I'm good.
Hey, how are you too? I guess we need to look to see if we can get like our supercharged battery.
Thank you.
I thought you should do it.